Ghost Ranch is kind of the idealistic old western set. There are these beautiful red cliffs that are surrounding the ranch itself. But down in the basin, just below Ghost Ranch, you get red and purple and green and white badlands. And those are the places that are really good to find fossils. It's definitely the best place to find early carnivorous dinosaurs in the world. I'm Sterling Nesbitt. I am a research associate of the American Museum. So starting in 1881, there have been a number of paleontologists that have searched these beds.
It really wasn't until the 1940s, right after World War II, that one of my predecessors, Ned Colbert, began excavating at Ghost Ranch. When Ned Colbert and his assistant, George Whitaker, first discovered the quarry, they thought it was probably just one or two little dinosaurs sticking out of the side of the cliff. But it is one of the world's great deposits of dinosaurs of any kind. My name is Mark Norell, and I'm the Macaulay Curator of Paleontology at the American Museum of Natural History. It's really unusual to find mass assemblages of dinosaurs. Occasionally, we find things called bone beds, where we find lots of different species and we find single individual bones. But the thing that makes Ghost Ranch so special is so many of the entire skeletons are there, just piled on top of one another.
Most of what Colbert saw were these delicate bones of a carnivorous dinosaur named Coelophysis barrii. When dinosaurs first appeared, they weren't the big animals on the block yet. They didn't dominate ecosystems anywhere in the world. They were all pretty small. When people think of dinosaurs, they usually think of T-Rex or giant sauropods like Apatosaurus, but this is what probably all early dinosaurs looked like. And then later they grew into the gigantic monsters in movies and in dinosaur films.
Ghost Ranch preserves our most detailed picture of late Triassic ecosystems in North America. Having all the Coelophysis specimens together in one bone bed like this, it's the closest we, as paleontologists, can ever come to really truly finding an equivalent of a living population. I'm Danny Barta. I'm a PhD student in the Richard Gilder Graduate School at the American Museum of Natural History. I'm interested in the growth and development of dinosaurs, particularly Coelophysis, because Coelophysis sort of set the standard for this body plan that we saw later carried to extremes in Tyrannosaurus and then Velociraptor, and this is the group that gave rise to birds.
We have an okay handle on the anatomy of Coelophysis, but we don't know lots of details. So even though thousands of skeletons may have been preserved, only a few dozen really are prepared, and out of those, only a few are really prepared well. These bones are really delicate, and once you expose some of these bones in the field or you have uncontrolled conditions, they just break and you can't get the pieces back together. So instead of taking each bone out individually, Colbert took out these big blocks of rock and bone and everything else, wrapped them in plaster, and brought them here.
One of the things I think people don't understand about collecting fossils is we go out on expedition and it's hard work, but what really takes the time is the preparation that we have to do to be able to expose these things. So when you look around a room like this, you look around the rooms that we have with the unopened blocks, these are really just libraries of objects. It's like if someone goes to the Vatican archives and they find, you know, something that was either penned by Leonardo or a Mozart manuscript. That's what we have here. And while it might take a while for it to be discovered, at least it's safe here and it's amenable to using new technology on, and it allows a whole future generation of scientists to be able to look at these things almost in their original context.
So with the specimens here, I will be making very thin sections of the long bones of Coelophysis, usually about 50 or 30 microns. We have to be able to pass light through them. When we look at them under a microscope, we often see growth rings, analogous to tree rings. And so we can count, you know, essentially one growth ring for every year. And this gives us an idea of how old all of the individuals in a population were when they died. Coelophysis is really, in some ways, kind of a model dinosaur for understanding dinosaur growth. By studying what coelophysis growth rate and metabolism may have been like, this will give us more detailed insight into how some of the evolutionary innovations we typically think of as occurring in birds, you know, high metabolism, warm-bloodedness, you know, when exactly all of those things evolved. These historic collections that were collected almost 70 years ago still have so much to teach us by applying, you know, techniques that have really only been developed in the last 30 years or so, like CT scanning and bone histology. We're able to gather a lot more data than we would have ever thought possible back when coelophysis was first discovered.
One of the real interesting things about Ghost Ranch is that it's come back into a real place of prominence in paleontology right now.
This is our 10th field season out there, and we're working in the formation just below where the coelophysis quarry was found. So it's a bit older. We don't know how much older, maybe 5 to 7 million years older. But what we have are relatives of dinosaurs, and we have some earlier carnivorous dinosaurs that are unlike anything else found anywhere else in the world.
It's not just the place where dinosaurs were found 75 years ago, it's the place where dinosaurs are found today.